Chris here, back taking a look at some mini PCs. So this is an Intel powered one with 11th gen in it, and it's from a company called Minisforum. They sent this out to me to review. It's their EliteMini TL50. Now the TL50 has the Core i5-1135G7 and Iris Xe graphics with its 80 executional cores, which is a big step up for integrated graphics performance, especially coming from Intel, and it's a welcomed change. Now this model here has 12 gigabytes of DDR4 RAM, 512 gigabyte SSD, which is NVMe. It ships with Windows 10 Pro, has dual gigabit LAN ports on here, Wi-Fi 6, which is the AX200 card from Intel, with Bluetooth 5. It can also take two additional 2.5 inch drives in this. Inside the box, you will find a guide. We have a bracket here and two cables for our SATA 3 drive. So it will take two 2.5 inch drives, which is really good. Not a lot of mini PCs can do that. Here is our VESA bracket and some screws to mount that behind a TV or monitor. Then we have an HDMI cable. Our power supply, this one is rated to 65 watts and it is using a Type-C connector, so a little different. Normally we have the DC round barrel plug, but not this time. And then an EU power cable. So depending on the model you order, what region, that will be a US, UK or Euro plug. The back here is where we have the bulk of our connections. So two USB 2s, two USB 3s, Gen 1, 2.5 gigabit LAN, and another 2.5 gigabit LAN. So very fast LAN on this and two of them, which is great. So you could use this, say, as a file server, a server. Now we've got display port. This is 1.4A and HDMI 2.0. So both of these are 4K 60. Our Kensington lock slot right there, and then the 9 volts, 65 watts total power in there. For that with the Type-C power supply that is supplied. Here we have power on with status LED behind it, two microphones, so these are dual array mics, another two USB 3.0 Gen 1 ports here, and this is Type-C USB 3.1, and that's display out 4K 60. So in total, we get three 4K 60 displays that this can run, which is great. And then we've got our separate audio jacks in there. And here on this side, there is an intake vent, a reset. This is for the BIOS. If you mess up any of the settings, you can simply reset it from there. You don't have to open it up, disconnect the battery, anything like that. And another intake vent there. So this part around the outside, that is made out of alloy. And then the top of it here, so there's a gap around the outside, that is for ventilation. This is plastic, and our wireless antennas, this is the Wi-Fi 6 that it has, they are stuck to the top of this plastic lid here for maximum signal reception. And then turning it over, you can see here some more vents on it and where you slot in that VESA mount, so you can mount this on the back of a TV. And then removing the rear lid is where we can gain access to our NVMe drive. And if you remove it, underneath is our wireless card. Now, if you're wondering, what about the 2.5 inch drives? So you can install two of them. That is possible, which is really good. And you can put them both on here. Okay, and there's vents there and you plug them in just here for the SATA 3 drives. But what's missing, in my box at least, is the screws. So the mounting bracket goes over them, holds them into place, and you're supposed to screw it down here. But those screws are sadly missing. And when it comes to further upgrades with this, so if you do remove the main motherboard, I believe on the other side there is no SODIMM slot. The RAM, this is configured with 12 gigabytes of RAM that is soldered onto the motherboard, and that's it, okay? That's the way it is configured. No upgrade, sadly, with this one when it comes to RAM. First up, our BIOS. So there's not a lot to show you. Unfortunately, there is no advanced settings tab, which would have been perfect, that we could go along and tweak some advanced settings there, increase power limits, but Minisforum don't want us doing that, unfortunately. So you can see there that this is the Tiger Lake, so the Core i5-1135G7, maximum turbo is 4.2 gigahertz, it's a quad core, it has the Iris Xe graphics, and it's a 10 nanometer chip, and you can see the RAM speeds there, they are quick. So this should definitely aid and benefit that integrated graphics, which I'll be testing later on in this review. So under security, there are secure boot things we can change here. The storage security configuration and the boot menu here is the one that
allows us to at least tweak a couple of things here. So just the wake settings, network stack configuration, and if you intend to run this as a server, file server, you want to change this one, the AC power loss policy, to make sure it's always power on for you, so it's going to power up. Now on first boot, you will be greeted with the following pre-installed language packs, and this is good. That means we don't have to waste time downloading any of these extra languages. So I'll skip ahead. I won't go through that setup part, of course. Everyone knows that, and it's incredibly boring. So this mini PC, it does come with Windows 10 Pro, and you can see I'll RAM the 12 gigabytes there, which runs at 3.7 gigahertz, which is rather fast. Now they have dedicated a little bit, 300 megabytes to the Iris Xe graphics, and I'll just bring this menu up here. Take a look at the performance there. You can see that the memory speed, very high, but it does actually scale down. It clocks itself down. I've been seeing it doing this quite a lot, and that would just be saving on energy is one of the reasons it's doing that. So it's not actually sitting at that top speed the entirety of the time you're using it. No, it actually does fluctuate a little bit there. So the drive on board this one is the Kingston, and it is NVMe, and you can see the speeds here. They're not bad. Definitely faster than SATA 3. So you can install an additional two SATA 3 drives if you wanted to do so. You could even run a SATA 3 as a boot drive and use the NVMe slot to NVMe to external GPU if you wanted to do that. Now, for a PCIe drive, these are not the fastest. It's definitely no Samsung PM981 or a Samsung Evo drive. So if you wanted faster, that is definitely possible there for upgrades if you wanted to install, say, a terabyte drive there. So I wanted to point out just a couple of other things, a nice little pleasant surprise here that we can run with the display out, at least here with my LG CX that I have. I'm able to run 4K at 120 hertz, but it is 8-bit when it's doing that, okay, 120 hertz there. And it looks very smooth, and I cannot really see the difference between the 8 and 10 bit there with it. The main thing is getting that 120 hertz, if your 4K display supports it, is really good to have. Now, XTU, can we undervolt? We can't. Okay, I tried to install it. This is the latest version of XTU. Maybe there's a way around this. I know that there are some forums, there's some shortcut or some sort of hack you can do to try and get it to run, but it looks at this point anyway that no. We're not able to undervolt Sandy with this particular processor. So benchmarks that I've run, Cinebench, I've just finished this one up, and I mean, it's okay. This result I did expect to be a little bit better, just short of, well, just over 5,500. Now, I was expecting this to be over 6,000. Now, I noticed that it got very hot, and I'll get onto the thermal soon, and that is why the score is a little bit lower. So some thermal throttling took place. It was bouncing around the turbos between 2.9 and 3.7 across all of the four cores, and that's why that score could have been better there. And the same goes for Geekbench 5, that it did actually touch on thermal throttling for a little bit, and that's why the score, I believe, could be better here. So slightly disappointing. I mean, the single core score there for a 4.2 gigahertz turbo and the multi-core for a quad core with the 8 threads, it isn't bad. I mean, don't get me wrong, it's not bad, but I was hoping for better there. And the Iris Xe graphics, this is the OpenCL score, which is a big step up from the Intel HD graphics that we normally saw, at least on the previous generations, like the 10th gen and the 8th gen and things. That's a nice step up there too with that one. And then our thermals. So far, this is what I'm seeing here with the thermals. 98 degrees. Is what it has peaked at. In fact, 99 degrees, and that's just after doing some stress testing. So yeah, it's not looking good. The fan is very good the way it scales up when it's hot, and then it just disappears. Once it cools down, the fan doesn't remain on. It then becomes very quiet. So it's not a loud machine when it's not being pushed hard, but when it's being pushed hard, it's reasonably loud. I wouldn't call it actually loud compared to my gaming laptop. It's nothing, but it does make a bit of noise, and you will hear it. But sad to see this. The thermal throttling that's taking place, hitting 99 degrees, isn't exactly good. I know it is a 28-watt processor. Maybe I've got a bad thermal paste job, but I just don't think the cooler is really up to it. Maybe they need to put a beefier cooler in this one. So general performance of this particular mini PC is very, very good. It feels very quick, very snappy. Everything loads up fast. Start menu. It doesn't lag, so there's no point me going over what I would do on the more low-end machines like say the Jasper Lake that I've just reviewed or the previous Gemini Lakes. Now the file playback, very good. This is a super demanding file here and it plays it with absolute ease. This one is HEVC 10-bit 4K, not a problem. And even 4K 60 Sony Swordsmith file. This one, very, very good again. No problems with this whatsoever. Really quick, and wherever I go, it just doesn't drop a frame there. Same with YouTube performance. Again, really good, not a problem. Now onto video editing. This is with Adobe Premiere Pro 4K timeline here that does have some 100 megabit files in there. So I noticed that with the preview, I want to keep it on a quarter because otherwise it seems sometimes to be not laggy, but it's dropping frames, just a little there. So what I'll do now is an export, and we'll see how long it's going to take for 1 minute of footage. Now this is something that I normally always test out on these particular mini PCs. And it shouldn't take long at all. For 1 minute of footage should just be over about 1 minute, especially now we've got the 80 executional cores with the Iris Xe. So the preset I use here is the YouTube one, 4K. And I'll just adjust this now to 1 minute of footage and we'll see how long it's going to take. Okay, so 1 minute right there, hit start and it's a delay of about 2 seconds and export right here. And it should be able to power right through this. And that is actually looking like, yes, definitely going to be under 1 minute. That is very quick, thanks to the Iris Xe graphics. And we just have a few seconds left. So once the bar disappears completely, 100%, that's gone. I'll hit pause. So you're looking at approximately about 48 seconds for 1 minute of footage. So we're now under 1 minute in code times for a quad core. This is good. So this is where the 10 nanometers and especially the Iris Xe does pull ahead from the Intel UHD integrated graphics that we had on the previous generations. It's just so much quicker at exporting video using that Intel QuickSync. Now for gaming performance, so this is where we should see a really nice step up in performance because we've now got, well, the 80 executional cores, Iris Pro graphics, and the faster memory. That should be helping out a lot. So this is 1080p on the medium sort of to normal low settings here. And it's looking good. Look at this. 60 frames per second. So that is a huge step up. This is, it's not quite double the performance of before. I mean, the UHD graphics would have been approximately 30, 40 frames per second right now. So that is, it's a nice bump up. A very nice bump up here in performance. In fact, it would have been lower than that. It would have really been about 30 frames per second, 1080p, because I used to test it out at 720p. So overall, I'm happy with this increase here, and it is quite quiet when gaming right now. There's a bit of tearing coming through on the screen there, so ideally you would put VSync on, of course, and that would avoid that problem there. The Witcher 3 now, so this is running in the mid-40s average 1080p on the low settings preset. I think most people would run it on low settings because you put it on a medium setting, then it does get into the mid 30s, late 30s, so not ideal. But this frame rate is excellent. This is really good. So this is around the AMD Vega kind of performance and sometimes even a little bit better at times. And the thermals holding up well. It's only around 64 degrees here. So when gaming, the thermals are fine. It's just when you run things like Cinebench and benchmarks and stress tests, it will hit 99 degrees. But for the normal kind of computing and the gaming, the thermals are fine. So great to see these big leaps now in the integrated graphics performance. It's well overdue with Intel especially, and they're finally, of course, on 10 nanometers away from 14 nanometers, which took them, again, like a lifetime to get onto the smaller process. Counter-Strike now, so this is 1080p, lowest possible settings, and the average frame rate here is well over 100. And if you even have a high refresh monitor, you could take advantage of this. But of course, I would keep it on the lowest settings here. You don't really want to go, whoops, grenade, ouch. You do not really want to put it on the high settings here. You want to keep that frame rate really, really high as possible. So the Iris Xe is a huge step up. With the 80 executional cores with this model here, this performance, I'm really happy with. I think for integrated graphics and such a small little mini PC, this is really good. I wonder where he is. He's waiting around here somewhere hiding. Ah, got me. Where was he? No idea. Oh, hiding there. I completely missed him. Anyway, that's enough of my terrible Counter-Strike gameplay. And lastly, our Linux support. So I don't have wireless for some reason. Now, normally it's detected this Intel AX200 card with this particular build here I've got of Linux Mint, the new version, the recently released, and it doesn't seem to want to work with it. I don't really know why, so I'll probably have to try out another Linux Mint distro, but I do believe Linux should be able to run on this just fine, considering I've gotten this far. It's just a minor driver issue, that's all.
Okay, so all up, there are quite a few areas of improvements with this particular model here. So we've got the 2.5 gigabit LAN, that's really good to see, and two of them. If you were going to be running, say, a router, file server, or server, this is a mini PC that you could do with that those LAN ports there. Definitely, it's something that a lot of people do actually look for, to have the extra LAN port. Now, this one, it does power on if it loses the power state, if you set it in the BIOS setting, but unfortunately, the BIOS options are really locked down. No advanced settings, which is a shame there. Now, the integrated graphics performance, very good thanks to the 80 executional cores, the faster RAM, it's definitely helping, and of course the Iris Xe performance, that architecture over, say, the 10th gen even. Iris Xe is a big step up over the integrated UHD graphics that we previously saw, which was downright, well, terrible performance for integrated graphics. So games like Counter-Strike, which are light engine titles, can run over 100 frames per second, and The Witcher 3 and GTA 5, and most games out there on 1080p on low settings will be playable, apart from maybe some of those super demanding new titles like Cyberpunk. I think will still be around 30 frames per second. You'll probably want to run that one at 720p, but it will actually be, well, playable and probably better than the PlayStation 4, at least with that. So that then brings me on to other things that are good about it. Well, 2.5 inch drive support is good, that we can add the two drives, but my unit has no screws for them. For some reason, they're not in the box, but that's not a massive thing. I can easily source those, but still, it should be there. And then the cons. So, thermals. You knew I was going to say that, right? The thermals. It peaks at 99 degrees Celsius there. It triggers thermal throttling, and that's not good to see at all. Now, it only happens when stressing it out with benchmarks, really. So, Cinebench, Geekbench, it would peak to about 95, but Cinebench really pushed it hard. And then it throttled and the cores dropped down across all of the four cores. So instead of holding, I think it was 3.7 it was holding originally, it dropped right down to 2.9, affecting greatly the performance there. So the benchmarks could have been a little bit better, I believe. Now, if just Minisforum, they adjust the fan profiles on this one. I think the fan profiles are good. I like the way that as soon as the temperatures drop, that fan RPM just completely goes away, and it's quite a silent unit. You only hear it when you're pushing it hard, really. But I believe if they set a lower point, a trigger point for when it starts to get warm, so if it kicks in the fan at a higher RPM a little sooner, it probably wouldn't peak to the 99 degrees for short bursts at least anyway. But with the long continuous loads, it will thermal throttle. So that's really the con for me. The other one is upgradable RAM support. Sadly non-existent with this unit. It is 12 gigabytes of some very fast DDR4 RAM, but because of the size of the heatsink in this, you simply cannot have the two SODIMM slots that we're used to seeing in these mini PCs from them. So they are missing. So you cannot just go and remove the RAM or add another stick, or I want to have 32 gigabytes in this. Unfortunately, not with this one. I would have liked to have seen definitely that upgradable RAM and maybe an NVMe slot, an additional one, instead of having the two 2.5 inch drive bays. But don't get me wrong, it's still great to have that option to add in just a huge capacity of storage. So that's the full story there of the TL50 from Minisforum. I think it's good in some areas, and it's just really the major one, which is the thermals on this. I do hope that they can somehow improve maybe the heatsink on this or the fan before it is released, because this is a pre-production unit. It's currently on what they call pre-orders, pre-sale at the moment there. So thank you so much for watching, and I do hope to see you back in the next one. Bye for now.